Poštovani prijatelji, uvaženi gosti, dragi gosti iz Italije, drago mi je da večeras na ovoj tribini u Novom Sadu mogu da vas pozdravim ispred Instituta za evropske studije, naše organizacije, odnosno instituta iz Beograda, koji je pozvao u goste kolegu Francesca Giubilija i našeg drugog kolegu Daniela Delorca, koji je takođe danas sa nama ovde, ali uglavnom će fotografisati, kako je on rekao, i pridružite nam se posle u debati. Dakle, mi smo u prilici da danas i sutra u Beogradu o 12 sati će biti prezentacija u Beogradu. Predstavimo rad našeg gosta Francesca Giubilija, pre svega, dakle, knjigu o kojoj ćemo večeras najviše pričati, pre svega u prvom delu, koja je njemu objavljena nedavno, pre par meseci, kod zaista izuzetno uvaženog i poznatog američkog izdavača Regnery Publishing. I knjiga se zove The History of European Conservative Thought, ili kako smo je lepo preveli, Istorija evropske konzervativne misli. Radi se o jednom zaista velikom uspehu za mladog čoveka kao što je Francesco. Francesco ima 27 godina, dakle, ali već jedno 10 godina ozbiljnog iskustva javnog rada. Danas mi je rekao da je sa 16 godina pokrenuo svoju izdavačku kuću, dakle, i kojom upravlja već 11 godina sa još jednim kolegom, a od njegove čak 20. godine je počeo da je profesionalno vodi i da objavljuje čitav niz vrlo zanimljivih izdanja, dakle, prevoda, na primer, klasika konzervativne misli na italijanski jezik, kao što je Conservative Mind od Russella Kirka, i tako dalje, i tako dalje. No, on je jedna vrlo, kako bih rekao, aktivna javna ličnost. Dakle, ja sam pomenuo pre svega njega kao izdavača. U pitanju je izdavačka kuća Historika u Rimu locirana, koja danas zaista objavljuje čitav niz vrlo zanimljivih savremenih autora na tom prostoru. Recimo, nedavno ovde čak razmišljamo da prevedemo jednu knjigu trojice mlađih autora koja se zove Sovranizmo, dakle, suverenizam, i koja je na jedan vrlo originalan način pokušava da objasni ovaj neki talas obnove suverenističke misli u Evropi, i tako dalje, i tako dalje. No, osim toga, on je sam, osim što je izdavač, vrlo uspešan i vrlo aktivan na italijanskoj sceni, on je takođe i autor nekih 6 knjiga manjeg ili većeg formata, od kojih je ovo prva knjiga na engleskom jeziku. Ostale su objavljene na italijanskom. Recimo, nedavno sad, pre evropskih parlamentarnih izbora, objavio je knjigu upravo posvećenu tom uspenu novih suverenističkih stranaka ili populističkih ili evroskeptičkih, kako ih definišu. Dakle, i ono što je meni isto vrlo zanimljivo, to sam ga zamolio da nam sledeći put pošalje nekako, to je na italijanskom objavljena knjiga Kultura di destra in Italia, ili Desna kultura ili Kultura desnice u Italiji, u kojoj on pobrojao onako najznačajnije autore na desnom prostoru u Italiji od 1945. pa nadalje. On je, osim toga, takođe, ljudi koji prate italijanske medije znaju ga zato što je redovni kolumnista za dva vodeća dnevna lista, kao što su Il Giornale i Messaggero. Osim toga, često se pojavljuje i u televizijskim nastupima, kao što je politički talk show na, recimo, Rai, njihovoj nacionalnoj televiziji, i tako dalje, i tako dalje. I nedavno je, recimo, u Americi imao turu predstavljajući ovu knjigu, gde je bio gost, recimo, Heritage fondacije, govorio na nacionalnom radiju, i tako dalje, i tako dalje. On je, osim toga, predavač na još jednom univerzitetu, gde predaje neku vrstu menadžmenta i rada u medijima, izdavaštva, i tako dalje. I pa ste, pričamo o čoveku koji ima samo 27 godina i za sebe ima zaista već karijeru koja je onako impresivna i za ljude malo starijeg formata. Zajedno sa njim naš gost je Daniele Delorco, novinar i izdavač iz Italije. koji je saradnik Francesca Giubilea u još jednom zajedničkom projektu koji se zove Nazione Futura ili Budućnost nacije ili kako bismo to već preveli. Dakle, oni imaju, to je jedan vrlo uticajan časopis koji su pokrenuli u kome skupljaju ovu, da kažem, novu ekipu ljudi koja deluje aktivno na desnoj intelektualnoj sceni, ali takođe imaju, dakle, što bi rekli, aktivni su i svoje krugove saradnju u čak 40 gradova, dakle, gde promovišu taj časopis i ostale aktivnosti koje su vezane za to. Dakle, ovo su dva mlada čoveka, vrlo aktivna, koji danas predstavljaju jedan, moram da kažem, od najistaknutijih aktera, jednog potpuno novog talasa nekih novih mladih ljudi koji se i u Italiji, ali i u celoj Evropi podižu radeći neke vrlo zanimljive intelektualne stvari. Danas smo zamislili ovo kao pre svega predstavljanje ove knjige, jer to je osnovni povod, dakle, u kojoj on uradio zaista jedan vrlo impresivan, kratak pregled različitih tradicija, jer nama uglavnom daju ono što znamo, to su američka i britanska tradicija koje su najprisutnije, međutim, on je uspeo ovde da za čitaoce koji mogu da čitaju engleski jezik prikaže detaljno i špansku, recimo, konzervativnu tradiciju i francusku i ono što je vrlo bitno, italijansku, mnogi ljudi poput recimo Orijanija, Preciolija, Moske i tako dalje, koji ovde ljudi vrlo slabo su imali prilike da čuju, ništa nije prevođeno i tako dalje. Tako da je u tom smislu napravio jedan vrlo lep bedeker ili uvod koji ljudima i na engleskom području, ali i drugima može da bude od koristi. Tako da ćemo u prvom delu zamoliti njega da nam predstavi ovu knjigu, neke najinteresantnije stvari odavde, koje smo, dakle, imat ćete mogućnosti da pratite, on će na engleskom izlagati, a mi smo obezbedili jedan prevod koji će ići na srpskom jeziku, a posle toga ćemo imati debatu u kojoj ćemo mogli da ga pitamo ne samo o teorijskim stvarima, nego i o tome šta se dešava u Italiji na političkoj sceni koju on veoma detaljno prati i tako dalje i tako dalje. Francesco, benvenuto. Počnemo komentare.
Thank you very much for your invitation. Unfortunately, I don't speak Serbian, so I have to speak in English. I don't know if everybody speak in English or understand English, but maybe we have a PowerPoint, so we can try to translate. I don't want to be very long, also because I think that interesting also to have a debate in the hand of the presentation. And the first part that is about my book, The History of the European Conservative Thought, I also want to talk about the political situation in Italy, because it is quite difficult to understand how is formed our government led by Lega and Five Star Movement. But before starting...
I will translate okay. It here. No? Dakle, kolega Đubili vas je sve pozdravio, izvinio se što ne zna srpski još uvek, do duše. I said that you still don't speak Serbian, but we will work upon that. I rekao je da će večeras pričati na engleskom, dakle, uz obezbeđen prevod u ovom prvom delu, u drugom delu ćemo ovako konsekutivno prevoditi i pitanje i odgovore. I on je ponovio, dakle, da želi da predstavi u prvom delu knjigu, ali da s druge strane, i zbog razumevanja konteksta iz koga on dolazi i u kome je nastala ova knjiga, želi da vam predstavi i sadašnju političku situaciju i vrlo složene odnose u italijanskoj vladi koju sačinjavaju, dakle, dve zanimljive grupacije, jedne Lega, dakle, ili Liga, Matteo Salvinija, a druga je, dakle, pokret pet zvezdica Di Maja.
Okay. So I can start and speak and stop in every 5 minutes so you can translate.
Yeah.
But before starting, I want to say thank you to my friend Misha. I met Misha 1 year ago in Latvia, in Riga, where we had a meeting with all of the most important, I think, European conservative thinkers, journalists. It's like a meeting, it's called Vandenberg. And in Riga, I had the occasion to talk with Misha, and I was impressed by his culture and his known of the Balkan situation, especially of Serbia, but not only of Serbia, of Albania, Montenegro, and for an Italian people, but in general for European people, I think that is very important to understand this country and very important to understand the Balkan situation. So I'm very happy to be here, and thank you very much to Miša for the invitation. So, what is conservatism?
Just briefly, uglavnom se zahvalio Đurkoviću ovde, ja se malo šalim. Mi smo se prošle godine upoznali na jednu vrlo značajnu instituciju koja se zove Vandenberg meeting, jedna tradicija, jednom godišnje se zaista najuticajniji konzervativni mislioci, pisci, novinari iz Evrope i zapadne istočne, jedno deseta kolega iz Sjedinjenih Američkih Država koje dolaze, dakle, vrlo uticajnih od urednika, recimo First Things Magazine, pa nadalje. Ove godine se to dešava na Oxfordu, recimo, i patron celog događaja je Roger Scruton, dakle, Sir Roger Scruton, čovjek koji je zaista najveće ime i u Britaniji, u jednom velikom delu Evrope, konzervativne priče, i mi smo se tu sreli prošle godine na zasedanju u Rigi, i tu smo napravili prve kontakte, i sad uglavnom me je hvalio da mu je bilo, jel, zanimljivo to naše poznavanje i to šta se, bilo im je zanimljivo šta se deša. Ja sam odložio jedno predavanje o tome, o pitanjima uglavnom porodice oko kojih se mi borimo ovde na Balkanu, dakle, tako da im je bilo vrlo zanimljivo da slušaju o Balkanu, šta se deša, u kom pravcu ide, i zahvalio se na mogućnosti da dođe ovde i da poseti Srbiju.
Yes, the first thing that we have to talk about is the word conservative. So, what is a conservative and what is conservatism? In Italy, there is an important publisher who died, I think, 50 or 60 years ago, that is called Leo Longanesi. He's not a very famous publisher because he's a conservative. And Longanesi said an important quotation, that is, I'm a conservative in a country where there is nothing to conserve. In Europe, and especially in Italy, when you talk about a conservative, the normal people say and confuse the conservative with a reactionary. So a conservative is a person, a reactionary is another person. I think that if we go in a street in Rome, in Naples, in Paris, but maybe here in Novi Sad or in Belgrade, and we say we are a conservative, people look at us in a strange way. They say, but what do you want to conserve? We need in Europe, we need in our country, we need in all over the world some reform to change the situation, to develop the situation. And this is the first important thing, because a conservative wants to conserve some issues. A conservative wants to conserve, for example, the identity of a country and the identity maybe of Europe, but not the identity of a European Union. And this is an important concept, because the Europe is a cultural concept. So Europe is Dante, Europe is Shakespeare, Europe is Goethe, Europe is a cultural concept, and the European Union is a political concept. So a conservative wants to conserve all the political issues. And another important issue that a conservative wants to conserve are, for example, the cultural identity and also the religion. The religion.
Okay, and then switch okay. to you know.
Translate.
Yeah. No, okay. Dakle, Francesco je krenuo polako da nas uvodi u celu priču i sad će polako krenuti na ono što je izlaganje ovde, ali je hteo još jedan segment da objasni, pre svega citirajući Lea Longanesi, jednog poznatog izdavača i novinara u Italiji, koji je rekao, ja sam konzervativac u zemlji koja nema šta da sačuva. Dakle, onaj problem na koji on ukazuje da je za razumevanje konzervativne priče jako bitno koji je kontekst, dakle, i o kakvom kontekstu se radi, u kome vi treba da imate nešto što čuvate i što želite da sačuvate. Sad je on krenuo da objašnjava šta znači u Evropskoj uniji čuvati nešto i koje su to vrednosti. Pre svega vezano je naravno za pitanje identiteta, koje je danas uz pitanje suvereniteta strahovito bitno za ljude i u Italiji i u mnogim drugim zemljama, i zbog toga konzervativna priča postaje sve zanimljivija za ljude.
Yes, and another important issue for a conservative is the religion, and especially for a European conservative, the Christian religion. We are Catholic, you are Orthodox, in German they are Protestant, but we all have common roots, and these roots are the Christian roots. And for a conservative, it's important to conserve these Christian roots. Other important thing that maybe is linked to religion, but not definitely, is the concept of the family. For a conservative, a society is based on the concept of the family. And there is another important issue for the conservative, that is the different, there is a book written by Ferdinand Tönnies, that is a German conservative, and in this book, Tönnies write about the difference between the concept of community on one way, and in the other way, the concept of society.
Znači, još nekoliko stvari je pomenuo koje su ključne za razumevanje toga šta se konzervira, odnosno šta se čuva. Kao prvu stvar je pomenuo religiju. Dakle, on dolazi iz katoličke zemlje, ovde je u zemlju u kojoj su uglavnom, dakle, pravoslavci, naravno, postoje i katolici i protestanti i tako dalje, ali različiti ljudi iz hrišćanske kultura za koje je hrišćanska tradicija strašno bitna i on smatra da je u Evropi vrlo bitna da nju konzerviramo ili da je sačuvamo. Druga stvar strašno bitna u svim ovim debatama u poslednje vreme je pitanje porodice ili onoga što je naziva prirodna tradicionalna porodica i on smatra da treba da se borimo da bismo nju sačuvali i na kraju je pomenuo onu čuvenu Ferdinanda Tenijasa, ovaj nemačkog mislioca, distinkciju poznatu između zajednice i društva na neki način i smatra da je ovaj koncept, dakle, zajednice strahovito bitan da bi se čuvao nekoj tradiciji.
Yes, and the big difference between a society and a community is that we live in a society. Again, if we go in a street in every European country, we live in the same city, in the same nation, in the same continent with some people, but we don't have a lot of things in common with these people. A community is a group of people that has a lot of things in common. So they have a religion in common, the identity in common. And conservatism, born in 1719 with an important book written the year after the French Revolution that is called Consideration about the French Revolution, and it was written by Edmund Burke. Edmund Burke is an English and Ireland philosopher, and in this book he tried to oppose to what is the French Revolution.
Dakle, on opet podsjeća na značaj ideje zajednice, dakle, pre svega, i on, recimo, govori o tome da kad izađete napolje u društvo, srećete razne ljude koji pripadaju opet različitim kulturama, ali da je suštinski ono što povezuje ljude u zajednici, neka zajednička kultura, zajednički osjećaj pripadnosti i tako dalje, i da je to nešto što je strašno bitno da bi se sačuvalo. I naravno, u ovoj konzervativnoj tradiciji on podsjeća na sam početak, dakle, to je u ovoj savremenoj tradiciji i on iste od te godine percipira početak ovde, dakle to je 1789. i Francuska revolucija, dakle i knjiga koja je sledeće godine objavljena 1790. godine, čuvena razmatranja ili razmišljanja o Francuskoj revoluciji Edmunda Berka, koja se smatra, dakle, početkom moderne konzervativne misli.
In fact,
please, we should start with the presentation. You
okay.
Know, so, okay, that
great,
we
great.
Could have also some
okay,
time
yes.
after that. So,
and sure. So, and the main representative of American conservatism, because the conservatism born with Edmund Burke, how I said, but after Edmund Burke, there are a lot of American writers that talk about conservatism, and the most important American conservative writers are Robert Nisbet, Russell Kirk, and Richard Weaver. American conservatism is different from European conservatism. There are some important differences, but the period of the last century where published most of the conservative books, most of the important conservative books, it was between 1948 to 1954. In this period, I read the title of some important conservative books that are Ideas Have Consequences by Richard Weaver, Good and Men at Yale by William Buckley, and especially the most important conservative book in of the last century is The Conservative Mind. The Conservative Mind is a book written by Russell Kirk. Russell Kirk is an American philosopher. He was an American philosopher and writer, and in The Conservative Mind he tried to summarize what is the conservative thought from the French Revolution to the modern age. Another important conservative thinker is Frank Meyer. In Frank Meyer is important because in his book In Defense of Freedom expressed the theory of fusionism. What is fusionism? Fusionism is a theory where he divided conservatism into two categories, the libertarian and the traditionalist, and he tried to summarize all the different of the conservative to one conservative thought, and that's why it's called fusionism. Another important conservative American thinker is Thomas Eliot. Eliot received the Nobel Prize in 1948 with his poem The Waste Land, and Eliot opposed in his book to the secularization of the society, and he opposed to modernity in general. Other important American thinkers, there are a lot of important American thinkers like Richard Weaver or Robert Nisbet. For example, Robert Nisbet wrote a book that is called Conservatism, Dream and Reality, where he writes about the traditional reality of conservatism. Other important thinkers are Peter Viereck or William Buckley and Samuel Huntington. And the interesting concept of American conservatism is that it's linked with the political situation. For example, one of the most important American book is The Conscience of a Conservative, written by Barry Goldwater. Barry Goldwater, he was the candidate in 1964 to become president of the United States. He lost, but after Goldwater, after I think 20 years more or less, Reagan became president of the United States. And we can say that Reagan is the first American conservative president. But how can I say the American conservatism is quite different from the European conservatism? The characteristic of European conservatism is that every country in Europe has a different view of conservatism. So we can talk about the most important country for the conservative thought, that is British. In British, I already talked about the book The Reflection on the Revolution in France, or the Reflection on French Revolution, written by Edmund Burke. This is the first conservative book published in 1792. But the other important conservative thinker of today is Roger Scruton. Misha talked about Roger Scruton. Roger Scruton writes a lot of books about conservative thought, but maybe I think that the most important Roger Scruton book about conservatism is The Manifesto of Conservative. And he's curious because there is also another Italian author, maybe we can talk about him later, but the most important Italian author is called Giuseppe Prezzolini, and Prezzolini wrote a book that is called Manifesto of Conservative, like Roger Scruton. And if you want to understand what is conservatism, I don't know if in Serbian there are some books translated by Roger Scruton, but if you understand English, I think that the most important author to read to understand what is conservatism today is Roger Scruton. In Roger Scruton wrote a lot of pamphlets about conservatism, and he summarized all the most important issues of conservatism. Another important issue about conservatism is the concept of the Western culture and the Western civilization. And Scruton is also focalized about the conservation of the nature. We know that the nature, maybe in the public imagination, is a concept linked with the left, but in reality the conservation of the nature and the anti-environment view of the society is sometimes linked with also the conservative thought, like in Roger Scruton. So, after the British conservatism, we can talk about the German, Austrian and the Prussian conservatism. Maybe the most important conservative author during the Austro-Hungarian Empire were Adam Müller. Adam Müller published a book in 1809 where he defended the concept of the empire against the reform. And in a political view, we can talk about Metternich. Metternich, with his restoration, we can define Metternich like a conservative author. And in the German Empire and in Prussia, in German, there is a very, very important thought, a very, very important conservative thought, especially during the 19th century, but also in the 20th century. One of the most important conservative writers that I think everybody knows is Thomas Mann. Thomas Mann is definitely a conservative author. One of the most important books of Thomas Mann is Buddenbrooks, and this is an history of the conservative society and is set in Lübeck, and it tells the story of the decline of the middle class family. But another important, maybe the most important work, conservative work by Thomas Mann, is the Reflection of an Unpolitical Man. It's not a well-known book, it's a very strong book, and is not a fiction book, it's a non-fiction book, and is a book about conservatism. Another important author in the German context is Arthur Müller van den Broek. Van der Broek is famous because he introduced a concept that is the concept of a revolutionary conservatism. We say that or you are a conservative or you are a revolutionary. But in German, during the Weimar Republic, there was a current of thought that is called the revolutionary conservative. They say the society, how is now, is not a conservative society. So we lost what is the status quo, we lost the identity, we lost the religion. So we have to do like a revolution, but not a revolution like French Revolution with a Jacobin view of the society. But we have to do a revolution to change the society and to come back to a conservative society. And the most important author link with the revolutionary conservative is Van der Broek. Another important German conservative author is Oswald Spengler. Spengler wrote a very important book that is called The Decline of the West. This book was published in 1919, and in The Decline of the West, Oswald Spengler, for the first time, explain why the Western civilization is declining. We are one century ago, imagine now how the situation is changed. Other conservative author in Germany is Carl Schmitt. Carl Schmitt is very famous. The concept of the political in Carl Schmitt is important. Carl Schmitt wrote a text about concerning European conservatism. He wrote, by nature, the conservative element is inseparably linked to the historical distinction. In Europe, every especially conservative value, such as religion, tradition, culture, gave life to ecclesial, state, and national distinction. The romantic matrix of Catholicism, realism, the dynastic sentiment of Evangelian Prussian, and the link between Russian orthodoxy and theistic autocracy made up three different conservative power from a religion and national point of view. So Carl Schmitt explained which are the difference from nation to nation in Europe about conservatism. And there is also Ernst Jünger. Jünger is one of the most important German writer. He is definitely a conservative, but is in general an important German writer. And Jünger write a lot about the Fourth World and in general about the view of the conservative view of the society. Also, the French conservatism is very important. The French conservatism is more linked with a reactionary view of the society and is very linked also with the nationalistic view of the society. The first author in the world that used the word conservative is not Edmund Burke, but is a French author that is very famous, that is called Chateaubriand. And Chateaubriand became one of the writers for the paper Le Conservateur. And in this paper, he used for the first time the word conservative. But in the French conservatism, there are also other important authors. I talk about, for example, Charles Maurras. And Maurras is one of the most important, not only conservative author, but in general nationalist author. But there are also authors like Maurice Puyo or Henri Vagos. And the concept of Action Française is definitely a conservative thing. Also in Spanish, there is an important conservative thought. One of the most important Spanish author is the philosopher José Ortega y Gasset. The most important book of José Ortega y Gasset is called The Rebellion of Masses. And we can link José Ortega y Gasset with other Italian important thinkers that are called the theory of elites, that are Vilfredo Pareto, Gaetano Mosca, and Roberto Michels. they summarize the concept of the elite. So they say there is a difference in the society between the normal people and the elite. The elite is a group of people that has to lead the society and government the society. And they say that the elite is a good concept. In our society today, there is a distinction, I think, between the elite and the establishment. For example, the European Union is led by an establishment. It's led by an establishment that for a lot of time, they do the interest of French people, of German people, against, for example, Italian people or people from other country. But the elite is a good concept in history because the concept of direct democracy is difficult to apply in a modern democracy. So in a democracy you need a group of people that government all the people that are called the elite. And José Ortega y Gasset in the book The Rebellion of Masses explain how the masses sometimes can go against the elite. Other two important Spanish authors are Juan Donoso y Cortés and George Santayana. Donoso y Cortés, for example, summarized the concept of conservatism in four words that are Dios, Patria, Fueros and Rey. God, the country, and the king, and in his view of the conservatism, these are the most important words. And finally, we arrive to Italy, to Italian conservatism. Italian conservatism is full of author and is full of not only a philosopher or journalist, but also, for example, publisher and also important writer. For example, one of the most important book of the Italian literature is called The Leopard by Giuseppe Tomasi di Lampedusa, and Tomasi di Lampedusa was a Sicilian author, and this is definitely a conservative author. But we can find some conservative view of society also in Dante, for example, and also in the society of Machiavelli, that are maybe the two most important Italian writers. But in the modern age, the most important Italian writers is called Giuseppe Prezzolini. Giuseppe Prezzolini wrote a book that is called Manifesto of Conservative, and in this book, I put in the back front of this book, the true conservative is keen to guard himself from being mistaken from a reactionary, a traditionalist, antiquarian, or nostalgic. So he explains how a conservative in our society is every time confused with the, how we say before, with the reactionary, but there is also another confusion between the concept of a conservative and the concept of a classical liberal. There are a lot of difference from a classical liberal and a conservative. A classical liberal person is more linked with an individualistic view of the society. A conservative is linked with the commune view of the society. So the community is the center of the conservative thought. And Prezzolini talk about the concept of the true conservative. In Prezzolini's view, the true conservative intends to carry on by presenting rather than turning back to retry failed experiment. And it's important to understand the concept of conservatism, that a conservative person is not against the innovation. A conservative person is against the revolution and is against progress. So Prezzolini explained that if there is an innovation, and this innovation is good for the people, and this innovation don't go to touch the important value of the society, the permanent principle like family, like religion, or like cultural identity. So the conservative is open to innovation, and this is the most important difference from a reactionary. Other important conservative Italian conservative thinkers are Leo Longanesi. We talk about him. He is a very important publisher, and Indro Montanelli. Indro Montanelli is the most important right and conservative Italian journalist. He founded the newspaper Il Giornale. Il Giornale today is the most important conservative newspaper in Italy, is owned by Berlusconi. Berlusconi is not a conservative, he's more a classical liberal, in a strange way, but he's more a classical liberal. And in Italy we don't definitely have, and now we can talk maybe about the political situation of Italy, because I think that is quite interesting to understand what is the political situation in Italy.
I will just briefly summarize that. Actually, so, okay, da pređem na srpski, skuza je. Znači, malo je ubrzao, zato smo ovako žurili sa, sa ovom celom pričom. Ideja Francescova je da vas ne udavi sa predavanjem od 50 minuta. Probao je da onako baš napravi jedan kroki ovih najvažnijih imena, zato je vrlo brzo proletao, pre svega koncizno pominjući neke imena i hvatajući se za ono što su osnovne diferencijacije u ovim različitim tradicijama konzervativne misli, gde je recimo išlo se između ove više libertarijanske, koje je u neko doba afirmisala slobodu i recimo slobodno tržište, i s druge strane ove tradicionalne koje afirmiše tradiciju zajednice, i pre svega ono što na čemu je on insistirao na kraju sumirajući jeste da konzervativizam, kako ga on vidi, dakle, nije tradicija koja je protiv promena, nego da je pre svega tradicija koja je protiv revolucije, dakle, protiv onih promena koji se zalažu za radikalne rezove i za razaranje neke zajednice, nego je suština da se prihvata, naravno, inovacija, pokretanje, evolucija društva, ali učuvanje neke sigurnosti i osnove, i to je ono što je uglavnom bila opsesija svih ovih različitih tradicija koje je on predstavio. I ono što je zaista velika, da ponovim i to, ona velika, veliki doprinos ove knjige, što za razliku od većine ovih, pre svega, engleskih tradicija, na jedan vrlo sažet način je predstavio zaista najvažnije pripadnike konzervativne tradicije u, na primjer, italijanskoj istoriji ili španskoj istoriji, koju u principu vrlo slabo poznajemo. I sad je polako, idemo, već je krenuo da nas uvodi u ono što je sledeći nivo, odnosno debata o tome kako danas gledati savremenu italijansku politiku, i pomenuo je, dakle, evo, završio, napravio je taj link preko časopisa Il Giornale, dakle, koji je dnevni list koji je još Prezzolini, dakle, osnovao, a danas je vlasnik tog dnevnog lista Berlusconi, dakle, čuveni, za koga on kaže, koji nam je poznat ovde, da bi ga on više stavio neki klasični liberalizam, ali da je on koketirao sa tim različitim ideologijama, i sad bi voleo nešto da kaže i o savremenoj italijanskoj političkoj sceni. Ok?
Okay, so the political situation in Italy is quite strange, and it's difficult also for the Italians sometimes to understand it, because now we have a government that is led by a five-star movement, and five-star movement is a populistic movement. It's a populistic movement, but is more linked with the left view of the political situation. And on the other side, we've got Lega. Lega is led by Matteo Salvini, and Lega is a national populistic party. Lega is not definitely at all a conservative party. In Italy, we've got another small party that is called Brother of Italy, Fratelli d'Italia, and Fratelli d'Italia is more a classical right party.
Dakle, što se tiče savremene italijanske političke scene, ona je veoma komplikovana. Vlada, kao što znamo, inače, italijanski politički sistem i sistem u kome se vlada, teško, retko koja vlada izdrži duže od 2 godine, dakle, inače, i sadašnja, gde se prave vrlo zanimljive koalicije, sadašnja vlada koja vlada Italijom nakon prošlogodišnjih izbora, sastavljena je od dve glavne struje. Jedna je, dakle, pokret 5 zvezdica koje vodi Luigi Di Maio, i koji on definiše kao jednu vrstu populističkog pokreta, ali bliskog levici, dakle, sa jednom levom socijalnom percepcijom države, i sa druge strane Salvinijeve stranke, dakle, nekadašnja Ligija Severa, koja se danas zove samo Liga, i koju on definiše kao više nacionalno usmerenu populistički pokret. On ga ne bi definisao kao konzervativni, jer oni nemaju preciznu ideologiju i pokušava da se postavi kao postideološka stranka, ali što se tiče neke, recimo, ideološki profilisane stranke, on je izdvojio kao konzervativnu stranku jednu drugu manju stranku u Italiji, koja sad ima 5-6% podrške, koja se zove Fratelli d'Italia, odnosno Italijanska braća ili Braća Italije.
Yeah, and we can define Lega and Five Star Movements are not left party or a right party. They are two post-ideological party. They are over the ideological view of the politic of the 19th century. It's quite interesting that, for example, in the big city like Rome, In Rome, in the last election, in the last European election, Lega took about 35%, 34% in all the country. But if you see the vote of the people in a big city like Rome, but also in Milano, also in Bologna, also in Torino, you see that in the richest part of the city, where the people traditionally vote for the right, so in the center of the city, where live the richest part of the Italian population, the people vote for the left, vote for the Democratic Party. If you go outside of the city, in the poor part of Rome, the people vote for Lega. But in this part of the city, in the past, people vote for the left party.
Okay. Upravo objašnjavate vrlo zanimljive promene u strukturi glasača italijanskih, dakle, i kako se promenilo to za koga ko glasa. Dakle, s jedne strane, kada govori o toj definiciji i strukturaciji italijanske političke scene, osim dve vladajuće stranke osnovne koje je rekao, postoji i takozvana demokratska partija danas, premijera do skorašnjeg Matea Rencija, koja se danas smatra nekom vrstom italijanske levice i uglavnom jesu sastavljeni od bivših članova komunističke partije, mada mešano ima i pripadnika hrišćanske demokratije, nekadašnje demokrišćana. I ono što je bilo zanimljivo, u centrima, dakle ono što je, da kažemo, elita ili vladajuća bogata elita koja živi u centrima velikih gradova, dakle Rima, ali takođe i Torina, i Bolonje, i Milana, većina tih glasača najbogatijih glasa za levicu, što je vrlo zanimljivo, dakle, a da s druge strane imate ljude koji žive u predgrađima ili u selima i tako dalje, koji su nekadašnji birači levice, dakle, koji su glasali za leve radničke stranke, danas taj narod intenzivno glasa pre svega za Ligu.
And why happened this situation? I come from a region that is Emilia Romagna, that is in a region of north of Italy. It's a very rich region, but it's a very red region. It's called the Leningrad of Italy. And in this region, there is one city that is called Ferrara. And Ferrara is the university city, the city of the writer Ariosto. It's an important city, not very big city. And in Ferrara, from the Second World War until 1 month ago, there was a left government. The mayor of the city for 70 years was a left mayor. In this...
I have to translate, right. Sorry. Dakle, on pokušava da objasni kako su se ove promene desile i pre svega hoće da to pokaže u kraju iz koga on dolazi, Emilio Romagna.
Emilio Romagna.
Dakle, to je pokrajina Italija, kao što znate, sastoji se regionalne države, sastoji se od 20 regiona posebnih, jedan od tih je Emilio Romagna iz koga on dolazi, koji je tradicionalno bio okrenut levici. Tu je, recimo, grad Ferrara sa poznatim univerzitetom i, kako on kaže, 70 godina posle Drugog svetskog rata gradonačelnici Ferrare su ljudi koji su dolazili iz levice.
And 1 month ago, for the first time after 70 years, there was the election and won a mayor of Lega. He won with a good result. Why happened that? And this is a symbol of all over Italy. Because the left, every time for a lot of years, refuse to recognize that there are big problems with immigration. Refuse to say to the people that there are some immigrants that do robbery, they do drugs, and the people become exasperated of this situation, and so decide, these people, ideological, are left people, but decide to vote for Lega against the immigration.
Dakle, šta je ključni problem koji je doveo do ovog obrata? To je pitanje imigracije. Dakle, Italija je, kao što znamo, od 2010. godine nakon Libije i takozvanog arapskog proleća primila na milione migranata koji su došli pre svega sa prostora Severne Afrike, ali i Centralne Afrike, i to je postao ozbiljan problem u gradovima, uključujući i Ferraru. Tako da problem zbog koga je došlo do smene vlasti u recimo u ovom gradu, posle 70 godina vladavine Levice, jeste to što, evo, dakle, pre mesec dana održeni su izbori na kojima je po prvi put, dakle, posle 70 godina postao gradonačelnik iz Lige, za koju možemo reći da je uglavnom više ili postideološka, ali više percipirana kao desna stranka u Italiji i pre svega zbog pitanja imigracije. Dakle, ljudi sa Levice, tradicionalno u Ferrari kao i u većem delu Italije i njihova inteligencija odbija da prizna da postoje bilo kakvi problemi koji su povezani sa ogromnim dolaskom imigracije u poslednjih deseta godina. Dakle, da ne postoje, oni odbijaju da govore o povećanom kriminalu, pljačkama, dakle, većem pritisku na socijalnu sferu i tako dalje. I nastavljaju da pričaju priču o tome kako je svaka imigracija dobra i tako dalje. To obični ljudi, međutim, dosta pogađa i zbog toga, kako on kaže, radnici i ljudi iz tog kraja koji su tradicionalno ideološki bili levi, prosto im se smučili ljudi koji danas predstavljaju levicu i vide da ugrožavaju njihove interese i zbog toga su se okrenuli, uslovno rečeno, desnici i po prvi put glasali za Ligu, jer Liga, kao što znate, izrazito vodi anti-imigrantsku politiku.
The situation in Italy is not danger like in France, because in Italy we have more social control, we still have a strong church, we still have an important value of the family, especially in the small town. The situation in Italy is not quite difficult for the immigrants like in Germany or in France. But the situation in the last year is becoming change. And the working class people are the people, the poor people especially, are the people that feel more this problem, because they bought, for example, 10 years ago, a house in a headquarter of the city, and after 10 years, the value of the house lost a lot. So they become to understand that they need a change, they need an important change, and they don't vote for Brother of Italy, because Brother of Italy is the right party. So they are ideological left people, so they don't vote for a right party, but they vote for Lega. They vote for Lega because Lega, yes, sometimes have also a conservative part, but in general is a post-ideological part, and they recognize in the fight against immigration or other issue that Lega is very strong.
Okay. Dakle, kad govori o tome šta je imigracija napravila Italiji, dakle, u kojoj meri je imigracija problem u Italiji, dakle, ova nekontrolisana, ogromna, preterana i pre svega ova koja dolazi iz afričko-arapskih prostora, on kaže da u Italiji još uvek to nije nivo problema koji ima, recimo, Francuska sa no-go zonama. Dakle, u Francuskoj, ovo ja dodajem prosto zone koje ne prate ovu celu priču, dakle, imate delove i Pariza, i Amijena, i Marseja, u kojima imate homogenizovane krajeve, u kojima država Francuska više ne može da obavlja svoje elementarne funkcije, policija tamo ne može da uđe, poštari, ne znam, hitna pomoć i tako dalje, prosto oni odbijaju da uđu, ili recimo imate u Švedskoj pre tri godine situaciju u kojoj je policija u jednom trenutku rekla ovo je 55 krajeva Švedske za koje mi više nismo odgovorni, mi tamo više ne možemo da obavljamo svoje tradicionalne funkcije. Dakle, u Italiji to još ne postoji, imigracija je raspoređena po celom kraju, međutim, on smatra da još uvek postoji dovoljno snage i u državi, ali i nešto što on naziva društvena socijalna kontrola preko porodica, preko raznih drugih paradržavnih institucija i tako dalje, koje još uvek imaju mogućnosti da ovu vrstu ogromnog prileva, koja zaista jeste napravila razne promene, drže pod kontrolom u smislu da ne ugrožavaju opstanak države, kao što zaista u Francuskoj država jeste na neki način ugrožena. Međutim, s druge strane, to ih pogađa, daje ovaj primer da pre svega radnička klasa u siromašnim krajima gde je imigracija došla u velikom broju, ljudi koji su tu imali kredite i kuće i otplaćuju, dakle, i dalje plaćaju kredite, a cene stanova koje oni imaju je radikalno počela da pada dole. A to je poznato, dakle, imate od Nemačke, Francuske pa nadalje, gde god imigracija krene dođe ovo u većem broju, po pravilu tu se uglavnom sele ovo domaće stanovništvo i cene stanova počinju da opadaju, tako da to počinje da ugrožava ljudi i oni traže nekog ko će po njima zaustaviti taj problem. I sad reakcija je bila takva da neće da glasaju za, recimo, klasičnu konzervativnu stranku kao što su Fratelli d'Italia. Dakle, oni su previše desno za njih i previše konzervativni, ali ovo što Liga nudi, dakle, jedna postideološka priča koja je pre svega usmerena ka zaustavljanju imigraciji i percipira se kao antiimigrantska, to je postalo zanimljivo i za klasične birače levice koji pre svega žele da zaustave, da očuvaju, što bi rekli, raniju prirodnu sredinu u kojoj su funkcionisali.
Yes, I expressed two more concepts and maybe after if there are some questions. And the two important issues linked with the political success of Salvini are in one way the immigration, we talk about immigration, and the, in the other way is the fight against European Union. Because in Italy people feel angry a lot against the European Union because we are in the European Union after Brexit the third economy. After Germany and France, and we are the third country for people. In Italy lived more or less 60 million of people, and for the Italian people it's difficult to understand why French and Germany decide all the political issue of European Union. So the people from Italy don't understand why the European Union every time attack our country and every time defend France or Germany. And Salvini understand this and summarize this.
Dakle, osim imigracije, dakle, koje je najvažnije pitanje za Italiju kao i za veliki broj evropskih zemalja, postoji drugo značajno političko pitanje na kome je Salvini dobio ovako veliku podršku, da vas podsjetim, na nedavno održanim izborima za Evropski parlament Liga je dobila 35%, dakle, i to je radikalan skok od prošle godine kad su imali 18%, dakle, cela ta grupacija. To je pitanje odnosa prema Briselu, odnosno prema Evropskoj uniji. Dakle, on podsjeća na to da posle Brexita, a sa izborom Borisa Johnsona, očigledno je da će nastupiti takozvani tvrdi Brexit, odnosno da će Britanija vrlo brzo izaći bez pregovora i tako dalje. Znači, nakon odlaska Velike Britanije, Italija je treća zemlja po snazi u Evropskoj uniji, dakle, nakon Nemačke i Francuske, dakle, i to je treća ekonomija po snazi, ali s druge strane i broj stanovnika, dakle, gde živi preko 60 miliona stanovnika, isto nju čini jednom od najuticajnijih, najjačih političkih, odnosno, snaga država u Evropi. S druge strane, postoji percepcija u Italiji da Nemačka, pre svega, i Francuska odlučuju o svemu unutar Evropske unije i da faktički Brisel sve vreme funkcioniše u službi pre svega ove dve velike zemlje, a da pre sve odluke koje oni donose uglavnom nisu povoljne po Italiju i da s te strane je prosto italijanski narod traži jednu vrstu pobune i nekoga ko će imati više snage da se izbori sa Briselom, da se koliko toliko uvaže interesi italijanske države i italijanskog naroda.
And the view of Lega about the European Union has changed in years. In the past, Lega say we have to go out of European Union, we have to do like an Italy exit, we have to come back to Lira, we have to go out of Euro. Now the situation has changed. They say, okay, we have to stay in the European Union, we are an important country, we are one of the founder of European Union. We have to do like an alliance with the Visegrad group, we have to do an alliance with other countries that are like us against France and Germany, and the important issue of Lega is to change European Union. So we don't want, like Italy, to go out of European Union, but to change the political situation of the European Union.
Dakle, Liga je, kao što je poznato, dosta promenila i svoj stav prema Evropskoj uniji. Dakle, da vas podsjetim, Mateo Salvini je preuzeo stranku od 2013. godine, dakle, pre šest godina, kad je ona bila regionalna pomalo separatističke stranke i tako dalje. Umeđu vremenu promenio se i odnos i način kako se shvata politika, i ranije Liga bila izrazito euroskeptička u tom smislu da je tražila Ital exit, kako oni kažu, dakle izlazak Italije po sličnom modelu kao i Britanija, dakle referendum o tome, tražila je povratak lire umesto evra i bila vrlo radikalna u svojim stavima. To je inače vrlo zanimljivo uočiti, nešto što ova takozvana radikalna desnica, uključujući i pokret Le Penove u Francuskoj, polako prihvata kao strategiju, dakle umesto direktnog radikalne borbe, na primjer za povratak franka ili lire, danas se prešlo na sistem u kome, kako oni tvrde, se traži promena Evropske unije, odnosno Evrope, iznutra. I dakle, napustila se ideja koja je s jedne strane plašila birače da će oni izgubiti faktički svoju ušteđevinu koja je u evrima i da će dovesti one izvesnosti, i prešlo se dakle na tu ideju koju Salvini danas zagovara, da treba praviti jednu široku alijancu unutar savez, unutar same Evropske unije, sa potencijalnim partnerima koji bi osporili ovu vrstu dominacije Nemačke i Francuske. Tu je pre svega zemlje Višegradske grupe, dakle Mađarska, Poljska, Češka i Slovačka, ali i drugi kandidati za zemlje koje su nezadovoljne sadašnjom dominacijom Nemačke i Francuske i koji bi pomogli da se napravi neka ravnoteža koja bi smanjila tu vrstu uticaja Brisela koja do sad postoje.
Yes, one last concept and after if you have some question. I don't know if Serbia has to enter in the European Union, but if you decide to enter in European Union, and I don't know if it's good or not good, I'm not Serbian, but if you decide to enter in European Union, I think that you definitely have to find some alliance inside the European Union, with the Visegrad nation, with Italy, with some countries first, and second, you have to remain in your own money. You don't have to enter in the euro. This is, I think, the most important issue. We can't come back to lira. It's impossible. It's totally impossible for us to come back to lira. We are not England. I think that is impossible. But if you are in a country that you want to enter in the European Union, you have to maintain your economic sovereignty about the money, and after you definitely have to find some alliance outside, but especially inside the European Union. This is, I think, the most important things.
Non ci lasciano mai.
Non vi lasciano
mai. Na kraju, poslednja stvar koju je hteo da nam prenese kao poruku, to je pitanje odnosa generalno prema Evropsku uniju, zemlje koja još nije kao što je naša. Dakle, pitanje, on ne želi da ulazi u ocene ideološke i vrednostne, da li treba ući, da li Srbija treba da uđe ili ne, kaže, to je naše pitanje i pitanje kako će naš narod o tome da se odluči, ali ono što u svakom slučaju bi, ukoliko se odlučimo da idemo u tom pravcu, preporučio, to je da se grade savezništva već sada, dakle, sa potencijalnim partnerima unutar Evropske unije koji razumeju ideju suvereniteta i koji bi mogli da pomognu da se pravi ta neka široka alijansa ljudi, odnosno tih država koji imaju potrebu da sačuvaju svoje nacionalne identitete i svoj nacionalni prostor, i tu je pomenuo naravno zemlje kao što je Višegradska grupa i tako dalje, koje po njemu misli da imaju dobru strategiju unutar Evropske unije. I u svakom slučaju druga stvar, to je borba da, iako se uđe u Evropsku uniju, da se sačuva što je više moguće od instrumenata monetarnog stabiliteta, pre svega da se ne prihvata evro, jer smatra da je to veliki problem za državu kao što je Italija, dakle da se ta vrsta monetarnog suvereniteta sačuva i da se gleda da se bude deo Evropske unije, ali faktički da se i unutar Evropske unije sačuva što više od tih instrumenata za odbranu nekog sopstvenog suvereniteta.
Yes, I don't know if there are some questions.
Definitely. I dakle, ovo bi bilo, da kažem, izvinjavam se što je ovako malo smo haotično, prosto hteli da spakujemo neke, da predstavimo malo i knjigu koja zaista samo po sebi vredi kao jedan vrlo...